This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Every single one of us over the years, and recently especially, has heard about power of positive thinking and how it does not work. We've probably tried to make our thoughts become reality and found that nothing happened. Well, there are reasons for this, and we're going to be talking about them today. In fact, we're going to be talking about the criticism of these processes and why they don't work and why they can. We are going to be talking, in fact, to Mitchell Horowitz. Mitch is a Penn Award-winning historian. He was a publishing executive for a long time and my editor at Tartar Penguin. He has got bylines in the New York Times, Time, Politico, Salon, The Wall Street Journal, many media appearances, and you can reach him on MitchHorowitz.com. He is also very active on social media and Facebook and so forth. His new book is The Miracle Club, How Thoughts Become Reality, and This Actually Can Work. Welcome to the show, Mitch.
Thank you so much, Whitley.
Well,
good to be here.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to have you on the show. Now, I think the place to start is why the book is called The Miracle Club.
Yes. It's named after some of my heroes. The Miracle Club was a salon of occult thinkers who gathered together on the west side of Manhattan, not far from where you used to live, actually, in the year 1875. And this little group was dedicated to exploring all facets of metaphysics, ancient philosophy, Kabbalah, mediumship, table rapping, ESP, talking to the dead. And the deal that they made with one another was simply that nothing was out of bounds as long as they could bring intelligent experimentation to the question. They stayed together only a very, very short time, but they formed the nucleus for a much larger and better known group called the Theosophical Society. This included Madam H.P. Blavatsky and Colonel Henry Steele Olcott and Thomas Edison and Abner Doubleday. And that group, of course, spread its wings and influence all throughout the world. And they really ignited the whole revolution in alternative spirituality that we're still experiencing today. And I wanted to recapture the informality and the spirit of experimentation that animated the original Miracle Club. Their motto was one word, try, with an exclamation point, try. And I always liked that. And I feel that we as individuals must never lose our taste for personal experimentation. And as long as there's no coercion involved, I don't see why anything should be off the table. And so both in homage to my original heroes and in a wish to reignite their experiment in a very informal way, but hopefully a serious way, I entitled the new book, The Miracle Club.
Now, this worked for some members of the Miracle Club. Are there any specific stories from them about the use of the techniques that they developed?
Oh, sure. Probably the most controversial of stories is that Madame Blavatsky and Colonel Olcott claimed that they were able to come into contact with these hidden masters or Eastern adepts of wisdom. And that has, for generations, been their most controversial claim. Lots of people said this was invention, this was fantasy, this was hype, and others feel very seriously that, in fact, Madame Blavatsky, a Russian occultist, and Henry Steele Olcott, a retired Civil War colonel, did in fact come into contact with some unknown or hidden school of adepts. And in fact, Madame Blavatsky later famously, or in some cases infamously, claimed that she would receive these phenomenally produced letters, these mysteriously timed letters that would reach her from these hidden masters or adepts, and they would give her advice, tell her what to do, and so forth. And when the Miracle Club was in session, and they were only around for a few months, they received one of these letters, and it said the following: do not give up thy club. Try. Again, there's the motto, try, with an exclamation point. Now, Madame Blavatsky and Colonel Olcott made lots of fantastic claims over the course of their lives about these mysterious masters materializing in front of them and all kinds of claims of mediumship and so on. And you know, in a certain way, it's easy to dismiss these things and say, oh, this was delusion or this was showmanship. But I always hasten to point out to people that whatever you think of these folks, their careers were so beyond the ordinary that it's difficult to believe that they were just hucksters of some kind, you know, selling metaphysics to a gullible public. They were so much more than that. They were so much more than that, however you assess them. Now, they left New York City in 1878 to relocate themselves to India. And Colonel Olcott and Madame Blavatsky at this point were well into middle age. They were not healthy folk. She was morbidly obese. He suffered from gout and suffered from a limp. And I mean, they were not in the prime of health. And they left the relatively comfortable environs of New York City in 1878, where you had gaslight and coal heating, and you could take a train out to Coney Island, and you could eat in restaurants, and you could afford servants. There was ice for your drinks. You know, they left the relatively comfortable environs for a very bustling cosmopolitan city for different regions, including very rural regions in India, where they did not speak the language, where there was no standard of conveniences or creature comforts or medicine that they had been accustomed to back home on the west side of Manhattan. And they did this because they believed they could better and more deeply pursue their study of Eastern ideas and esotericism in India. And while they were there, they played a vital role in instigating the Indian independence movement. You and I could talk about this for a full hour, and we cover only some of the bases. And all of these claims, unlike the claims of mediumship and hidden masters, are historically verifiable. They're an open book historically if one wants to research them. I write about it quite a bit in my first book, Occult America. It's difficult for 21st century people to conceive of even the physical bravery that it took for these people to uproot themselves from their fairly comfortable homes in Manhattan. And if they were interested in attention, or if they were interested in attention only, why not stay in what was then becoming the media capital of the world? They were widely known to the press. They enjoyed sparring with the press. In other words, there was every reason for them to settle into middle-aged life as, you know, somewhat infamous but celebrated figures, comfortable with lots of access to publishing and reporters and the print media of the day. But they took a radically different path and frankly, a physically dangerous path. It's so uncommon that people today in our digital world will actually place themselves in any kind of jeopardy for what they claim to believe in. They did. So I'd be slow to render summary judgments about any aspect of their career, you know, even those that were most controversial, because they themselves were beyond the ordinary as individuals.
Well, exactly. And to do that, and then for it to be said that you are perpetrating a fraud, it's a hard thing to reconcile. Because
very hard thing to reconcile.
In and that in fact, period, for example, you had to sail. There was no way. Getting Nothing. To India from New York was a months-long effort and dangerous.
Right. And there was no guarantee of your arrival. I mean,
none.
You know, this was not the age. We weren't even in the age of the Titanic yet, if you'd like to use that as a reference point for creature comforts. You know,
and here a woman with gout and overweight does that.
Yeah.
And you know, I've read Blavatsky's work, some of it, not all of it, and it is an absolutely astonishing, the sheer energy that was involved in creating it is brain bending.
It's absolutely extraordinary.
She was really deeply inspired.
Yes, she really was
energized too.
And that's why she will always remain a mystery. And people, it's funny. I mean, here we are. Well over, gosh, we're about 130 years since the woman died in London. And her name and her career still ignites deep controversy. Several years ago. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Don't go ahead. Let's wait. Let's take a little break for our free Dreamlanders. Sure. Folks, listen to these announcements. You want to experience a miracle in your life? Do what you're told in the commercials and you will. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant. But then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon. The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
We're talking to Mitch Horowitz, his new book, The Miracle Club, his website, MitchHorowitz.com, and you can also find him on Facebook and Twitter. We're talking about his new book, The Miracle Club, How Thoughts Become Reality. We've all had experience with this, I would assume, tried, and found usually it didn't work. We're going to find out why not and how to make it work. Because the book is filled with all kinds of practical ideas about this. And Mitch is a real expert. He's gone deeply into this. How long have you been working on the idea of thoughts becoming reality, Mitch?
Probably for about 20 years. It was probably about 20 years ago that I first came in contact with some of these metaphysical ideas, many of them American in nature, that your thoughts somehow replicate themselves in outer life. And I was immediately struck when I first came upon these notions, which I first discovered in a book called The Science of Mind by a very lovely man named Ernest Holmes, who lived and worked for most of his life in the city of Los Angeles. Ernest was a very beloved figure, spiritual thinker, who wrote on this theme of thought becoming reality. And when I first read Ernest, which was probably about 20 years ago, I was indelibly struck that there was a piece of the truth here. I didn't feel it was the whole truth, but I felt it was a piece of the truth. And that's pretty much when I began to personally experiment with some of these concepts. And I always felt this nagging sense that it was just a piece of the truth, that there were other intervening factors. Because we all, as you have been alluding, we've all had experiences, and we've all witnessed experiences in people's lives where things seem to actually go quite the opposite of what they wished for, even in atmospheres of encouragement and morale and love and focus. And yet, there is this also this uncanny congruency, this truly uncanny congruency that goes beyond confirmation bias or any easily explained coincidence between thought and actualized reality. And I've dedicated myself probably for 20 years from the perspective of metaphysics, medicine, psychology, in trying to trace out those connections.
Does it work for you?
It works for me, but I will add two very, very important caveats, and I must emphasize this, and I talk about this in the book. It works for me under certain circumstances, and they are as follows. One, sometimes there can be a significant interval of time between that which is wished for and that which unfolds. And that gestation period and that interval of time is very tricky because we are, by nature, profoundly forgetful and profoundly impatient as individuals. And a lot of philosophers have made the observation that our lives go in waves and cycles. This was something Goethe wrote about. And Goethe had a very controversial statement that eventually was morphed into what is to us a very familiar statement. That statement is, be careful what you wish for, you just might get it. In its original form, Goethe wrote it as, what you wish for when you're young will come upon you in waves when you're old. So be careful. Now, a lot of people want to argue with that statement because it seems contrary to reality. But I would say stop, slow down, take a yellow light, think again, look at Goethe's statement very, very carefully and ask yourself whether you don't detect uncanny strands of connection, both joyful and tragic, between thoughts and ideals you held when you were very young and things you experienced when you're older. There is this time interval that can obfuscate this connection between thought and event. That's one thing. The other thing is we live under a cosmic framework in which we experience multiple laws and forces, including physical laws, including geography, politics, and I would even say accident. I've never liked the expression, the New Age expression, there are no accidents. I can't verify that there are no accidents. I think we live under all kinds of laws and forces, of which the mind is one vital, precious part. And that's enough. That's enough to understand that there are non-physical dimensions to thought, which I think we have so much evidence of, we cannot run from that conclusion. Materialism just doesn't cover all the bases in the 21st century. So to understand that there are extra-physical dimensions to thought is in itself quite enough. That's why I tend to shy away from terms like law of attraction, because they imply the existence of one mental super law that controls everything. And I think that will lead you into a dead end. That will lead you into a dead end. The experience of living under multiple laws is authentic. It's to be honored. But within that experience, you can also incorporate the law of mentation, if you want to put it that way, as one tool. And that's an extraordinary enough place to start experimenting.
The law of meditation.
Mentation.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't. Okay, well, you suggest to me that I should ask you what the law of mentation is.
Just simply the notion that one of the influences under which we live, and an influence that's as vital as any other, is that there is a connection, there is a coherence between thought and event. It doesn't mean the law of attraction. It doesn't mean a mental super law, so to speak. But there's a thread of influence there, and that is in itself a fascinating place to begin experimenting.
Now, you, of course, it's impossible to discuss this. I would say it's not so much a philosophy as it is an inner stance, a way of being in life,
without
talking about Norman Vincent Peale and the power of positive thinking.
Yes.
You have a very interesting section in the book about Joseph Murphy, who wrote The Power of Your Subconscious Mind.
Yes.
And which was about extraordinarily effective get-rich principles, basically.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, you say here, those of us in the positive mind culture must face up, basically, to Peale's claims.
Mm-hmm.
And that suggests that there's a problem there. In fact, Arthur Caliandro, who was Peale's successor, mentioned that sometimes his sermons were juiced up. I actually heard Peale when I was a young man. My father took me to that church one Sunday in New York City. So, a long time ago, God, but I do go back. Let me ask you then, therefore, there's something dismaying, I guess is the right word that you use in here, that about the fact that Peale's methods, frankly, didn't work for a lot of people.
I'm glad you brought that up. Arthur Caliandro, who you mentioned, was a lovely, lovely man, liberal Protestant minister. He died several years ago. I sat with Arthur for probably what was the last interview of his life. Lovely person. I was on the east side of Manhattan. And he believed in Peale. He loved Peale. But he wanted to be plain for the historical record. And he did tell me, in his words, that Peale sometimes juiced up his sermon. That was his term. And he also explained to me that Peale had a weakness of sorts for kowtowing with powerful people. Now, this was several years ago that Arthur and I spoke, and one of the names of these powerful people that came up was none other than Donald Trump, who was also a congregant at Peale's church at the same time that you went there You might have sat next to him when you guys were 15 years old, for all I know.
Oh, and God. No,
I
think,
yeah,
that.
The truth. Sorry, Whitley. The truth hurts, but these are the facts. The Trump family attended that church. A lot of conservative folk attended that church. Richard Nixon attended that church, not someone who's widely remembered as a passionate, positive thinker. But and I was very grateful to Arthur because I felt that, look, we have to be adults, and I know Arthur loved Peel, and I admire Peel tremendously. I never knew him. But we have to be frank about these lesser parts of our history, and when a man like Arthur Caliandro, who was such an honorable, decent person, tells me that Peel juiced up some of his sermons, I have to believe that, and I know it's true. And at the same time, Arthur also would have said there was essential truth in Peel's theology, that Peel believed in a Christianity in which you could attain, you could succeed, you could aspire. And to some people, that sounds gauche, because some people feel Christianity is about humility and love of neighbor. Others feel it's about sin and salvation. And Peel did bring a different emphasis. And he was a serious man. He was serious in his theology. He cared about his theology syncing up correctly with the Protestant tradition from which he came. Marble Collegiate, where he preached, this is a Dutch Reformed church, and Peel wanted to be both Dutch Reform and mystical, and I think he succeeded. However, I think he also exaggerated. I think he also exaggerated, and I think that that's present in a number of New Thought writers, and people have asked quite correctly, gee, you know, where are all these miracles today? I keep reading in the books about this little old lady from Boise, Idaho, who imagined, you know, she'd have a car, and the next morning a Cadillac was parked in her driveway. And my response to those people is, I don't know where those miracles are today, so to speak. I don't know. I can tell you, I can give you testimony of things that I've witnessed that are quite extraordinary, but I can't give you them cut and made to order, you know, the way some of these old writers did. And I think some of these guys benefited from living in a pre-digital age where it wasn't so easy to follow up on some of these claims. And they might have repeated something that they heard somewhere, and they depicted it as a letter that somebody sent them or something, and nobody could trace it. I have witnessed extraordinary events. I have witnessed extraordinary events, but not on the scale that these guys described them, where I could give you one a week in a sermon. I can't. And I'm one of the things I write about in the book is that there has been a lack of principle, I think, in some of our popular metaphysical literature, in which people have created composite characters or have juiced up stories or have just played it loose with the facts. And it's unacceptable. It's unacceptable. How can you be trusted to speak on matters of ultimate truth if you can't relate facts plainly? And I have to say this, and I'm not saying this to flatter you, and it's one of the things I plan to talk about tonight. I'm speaking here in Los Angeles. To me, communion is a, and others of the books that you've written, but communion especially, is a case in point of what I want to encourage people to do. I want names. I want dates. I want locations. I want transcripts. I want chapter and verse facts. Because if we're going to write about extraordinary things, and may I always hold myself to these standards, and shame on me if I don't, if we're going to write about extraordinary things, our standards of reportage have to be very plain and very good. And I always encourage young people, especially, to read communion, because we've got to get out of these bad habits that we've inherited from past generations of playing it a little loose because, well, you know, it kind of happened this way, or more interesting things have happened, but I've lost track of them. So I'm going to exaggerate what did happen. I feel justified. You know, there's always we can play games with ourselves, sort of justify stretching the truth. And we can't do this. We cannot.
Yeah. You have to be incredibly careful, especially because it's not the mind, I know this from my own life, of course, wants to connect the dots so badly. My wife was a wonderful teacher. You knew her, I believe, a little bit. And
of
met
course.
Her.
Yeah.
And she from the very beginning, she was the one who chose to call the book Communion, and she was the one who made sure that I did not connect those dots
Right.
Because
right.
we can't, because what's going on there, whatever it is, it's real. And it has yes. to be, its reality has to be respected as a deeply sacred human experience simply yes. because it has the potential to lead us in extraordinary new directions. Now, I want to get on, but before we do this, folks, I think we'll just go on. We'll have the break at the half hour. I want to get into things like military strategy. They have the most unexpected chapter here called Military Strategy as Self-Help.
Yes.
The dynamic I've been describing, focusing and acting on a desire with singular commitment, plays out not only in the lives of individuals, but also in the events of nations and civilizations. Yes. We saw this process at work historically in America's involvement in Vietnam. Can you expand on that?
Yes. This is where it all comes together in a strange way. These very diffuse threads, in a way, that come together in this example with regard to Vietnam. Now, we were talking earlier about the commitment of Madame Blavatsky and Colonel Olcott, and how, at a somewhat advanced age, not in very good health, they made the journey from New York City to relocate to India, which at the time, I mean, this was before the Beatles. You know, this India was as unknown and as distant to the American mind as the surface of another planet. I mean, it really, truly was not a place that Westerner understood. And I thought to myself, there was something so vital and powerful in that commitment. And that's why we still know their names. Had they remained in New York City, they would be footnotes. But instead, they are names that live both in honor and infamy, depending on your perspective, and will evermore. And it has something to do with the nature of their commitment. And I think that's the turnkey, if there is one, to effectively harnessing the extraphysical mechanics of mentality. It is this absolute commitment, absolute impassioned commitment of a burn the fleet variety. If you're willing to lay everything on the line for what you believe in, things will happen. Not only, you know, speaking from a motor and cognitive perspective, but that again and again and again seems to be the vital turning point in the lives of people who experiment with mind metaphysics. So what does this have to do with Vietnam? Well, there was a military officer, a colonel named Harry Summers, who was a combat officer in Vietnam, and he wrote a book in the late 1970s called On Strategy. And a lot of military strategists and young officers at the time considered this book, On Strategy, to be the ultimate classic on America's defeat in Vietnam, not from a moral or from a political perspective, but from a perspective of military strategy. This was considered by many young officers to be the book on why the U.S. lost the Vietnam War. And it was this book was very heavily in vogue among young officers in the late 70s, early 80s. And Colonel Summers, who I knew briefly, he made the case that the United States had never actually lost any major battle, the South Vietnamese military was more capable than what had sometimes been reported, that there was no intrinsic reason why the U.S. went down to defeat in that war, but there was one overarching reason that guaranteed defeat. And in his view, that was a lack of political and moral commitment to the conflict, that there had never been a formal official declaration of war, that Lyndon Johnson and his advisors, including Robert McNamara, had this chimerical and failed notion that they could fight a limited war without sort of placing the nation on full-time war footing, without making the moral and political case to the public that there needed to be a full-scale war without asking Congress for a formal declaration of war. And Summers said that without an absolute commitment to the conflict from every perspective, militarily, politically, and morally, making the case morally to the public that this warranted a full-scale war effort akin to the invasion of Normandy. Without that, failure was guaranteed. Failure was guaranteed. And so Summers maintained that the United States should always and at all times stay out of these limited conflicts. Of course, we haven't listened to them, to him. We haven't listened to him, which is why
no.
There's this horrible, tragic, drawn-out conflict in Iraq that no one ever understood, that no one could ever quite grasp or gather. Why we read news of soldiers being killed in faraway places without most of the public even being realized that soldiers have been deployed to these places. We have not listened to him. We have not listened to him.
And we're still doing it. But we also, however, I wanted to touch on that, and we're going to take another break now, and then we're going to talk about methods in mind power, because this is the critical heart of your story and your book, it is where we all want to go, down a road where this works. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
Ever wonder what the close encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision. Not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audiobook of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on Audible.com, Amazon.com, Audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold.
Whitley Strieber, one of the great authors of our time. War Day changed the way we think about nuclear war. Communion led millions to realize that they had encountered the visitors. Superstorm gave a word to the world that has become the byword of our time. The Key is among the most prophetic books ever written. And where can you get inside the mind that created all this? On UnknownCountry.com, where Whitley's life stories, his powerful meditations, his books, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, and others are available in audio format. And so much more exclusive Whitley Strieber material. Join Whitley on the path to tomorrow. How? Subscribe to UnknownCountry.com today.
We're talking to Mitch Horowitz, his new book, The Miracle Club, How Thoughts Become Reality. David Lynch says Mitch is solid gold, and that is true. Mitch does know what this is all about, and he does know how to bring it into your life in a way that it actually works. He's basically a no bullshit guy, to be frank.
I'm going to quote that.
Yeah. Well, you are. I mean, because you cut through all of the stories and the fakery and the things that hyped up things that are designed to make big bestsellers and make the dreams only of the author come true.
Perfectly put.
Right. Methods in mind power. Let's go through it. Affirming, visualizing, meditating, and praying. Let's start with affirming. I don't want to go into great detail, but because, I mean, you need to read the book. If you're going to actually do this, that's the first place to go. What is affirming and what do you actually do? What do you do personally?
I'll tell you what I do personally, what I recommend. Affirming is just repeating a desired phrase to oneself. The most famous and most mocked, I might add, was coined by the French mind theorist Emile Coué, who told people to say, day by day, in every way, I'm getting better and better. And of course, this is supposed to expose the unseriousness of this entire movement. What mature person could believe that repeating a sing-song phrase like that could make any difference? But what people omit is that Coué had a very specific way that you should say that phrase or any such phrase, which is this. And I do this myself, and I do it religiously. In the few moments before you go to sleep at night, you enter into this kind of borderland zone that can be hallucinatory, and yet at the same time, you also have control over your own cognition. Sleep researchers call it the hypnagogic state, the hypnagogic state. We all enter it. It's just that few precious moments of exquisite relaxation just before you drift off to sleep. That is prime time for impressing the subconscious mind, for reprogramming the psyche. Psychical researchers have found that it's prime time for evidence of ESP and telepathic-related events. And use that time. Use that time for affirmation. That was Coué's genius, not arriving at a little sing-song phrase, but he had an instinct for something that sleep researchers and cognitive and psychical researchers later arrived at many generations later, which is that that particular state of mind is a very supple state of mind. That's when you should use your affirmations.
You mentioned the phrase, you used the phrase, sentence at one point, feel the pleasure of your attainment.
Yes.
And this, to me, very much relates to Norman Vincent Peale's message. But can you explain what that means?
Sure. And this actually ties in nicely to the question of visualization. My favorite teacher in the mind metaphysics tradition actually is a man named Neville Goddard, who also worked a great deal of his life here in the city of Los Angeles. He died in 1972. And Neville, I can't possibly sum up his career in a brief way, but he was a brilliant mystic and a beautiful man and a person of impeccable integrity. And his formula was to also use this hypnagogic state that I was alluding to, but instead of repeating an affirmation, he believed you should come up with a little scene in which you would interject yourself. Not as if you were watching yourself on a movie screen, but you should place yourself in the scene. If you want to see yourself climbing a ladder, for example, you really feel the rungs of that ladder folded beneath, in between your hands. You feel the weight of your feet pushing on the lower rungs of the ladder. You climb. And Neville's program was to come up with a scene like this and really try to capture the emotional feeling of being in the scene. So if you wanted a promotion at work, for example, you might see yourself getting your hand shaken by your boss, and your boss saying, congratulations, and you're feeling the emotion of achievement. And Neville's program, it's a very simple program, but it can be difficult because it requires almost some training in method acting in a certain way. You're really trying to capture the inner feeling of what's going on. It can be very, very powerful. It can have a very uncanny effect and influence on one's life, sometimes quickly, sometimes over a long interval of time. But his method was to really get into that feeling state of that scene. And that can be challenging for some people.
Yeah, it can be challenging because of the fact that we have a tendency to move through life kind of growling about our miseries.
Yes.
And I mean, if you look at politics, a lot of politicians lives and their whole presentation of themselves, including, frankly, Donald Trump, who was an advocate or went to Norman Vincent Peale's church, is kind of play on our fears and our miseries, even when they're not actually very important ones. Like right now, we're in a very good period historically. And yet, when you look at the newspapers, you see all of these horrors everywhere. The people coming up to the border and bombs being thrown at the powerful people and so on and so forth. But if you look at your own life and our lives, this is a wonderful time.
It's bizarre. And
yeah,
God only knows how history is going to judge us, because our generation, there's so much fear, there's so much anger, people talk in these apocalyptic tones. And I try to point out to people, 20 million people died of the flu during World War I, including in New York City. Can you imagine?
Do you know that you're only mentioning the number in the United States? It was 80 million worldwide.
It's unfathomable.
Inconceivable.
It's inconceivable.
Or the first day of the Battle of the Somme, 60,000 men died on that day.
It's inconceivable.
If that happened now, it would rock the world.
It would rock the world. Now, we have, in our hemisphere, 7,000 poor folk in a caravan walking through Central America, hoping to get asylum in the United States. And people are hysterical over this. And one battle, 60,000 of someone's kids lost their lives. And of course, never mind the fact that if you were to account for population differences, you'd have to more than quintuple that number today.
Right.
And we complain and we're angry. And as you correctly point out, oh my God, infectious diseases are at an all-time low. Deaths in battle are at an all-time low. The level of conveniences available to Westerners are beyond anything Jules Verne could have imagined. And yet, why, Whitley? Why are we?
Well, one of the reasons is really very simple. You can't sell news. You can't sell good news. It does not sell. You have to have bad news in order to sell. Yeah. Therefore, the news is always bad. And we become kind of doom junkies. And I mean, in my world, I study the climate, and I know we're in trouble with the climate.
Yeah.
Everybody does. But I also know that we have very inventive, and I expect us to find a way out of this mess eventually, and we will. So it concerns me, but it doesn't throw me into a state of despair at all.
Yeah.
Now, I want to move on from here. And folks, this is a very essential point I'm trying to make here. The first thing you have to do is to kind of step away from all of that negative noise and look at what you truly want, not in this awful, growling, low-level, miserable kind of mantra that goes on all the time in the media. And now let's talk about visualizing. Mm-hmm. Now, we've left behind all of the negativity that surrounds us. We're all alone with ourselves, and we're finding this is a really extraordinary, beautiful little creature here that's me, and mm-hmm. I want to visualize. So what do I do?
Yes. You go into an exquisitely relaxed state, preferably a slightly drowsy state. This can occur at night, when you naturally enter such a state. My philosophical hero, Neville Goddard, used to do it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, following lunch, go to bed, go to an easy chair, enter into an exquisitely relaxed state, one that borders between sleep and wakefulness without allowing yourself to cross the line over to sleep, because you want to maintain some control of your cognition. Enact a scene in your mind of something that you want, whatever it may be. You want to be married. You want a promotion at work. You want to come into money. You want recovery from an illness or something. Whatever it may be, you must feel this desire with a sense of passionate intensity. Our desires are our prayers, as Joseph Murphy put it. You must feel a sense of desire with an absolute, unconflicted sense of impassioned obsession, almost, something you truly want. It's very important. There must be no sense of contradiction. Go into a state of exquisitely relaxed immobility on your bed, on a chair, on a yoga mat, whatever you prefer, and concoct in your mind a scene in which you are experiencing something, something small, something very basic, that would confirm the coming to pass of whatever it is you wish for. The scene should be limited. It should be small. Because if you do it that way, it helps your mind to keep from wandering. Don't be overly ambitious with your scene. It might be as simple as a handshake. It might be as simple as somebody slapping you on the back and congratulating you or something, whatever it is. Run the scene over and over and over in your mind as long as it feels natural and emotionally persuasive. And then if you want, you can allow yourself to drift off to sleep, or you can rouse yourself and go back about your day. Do it consistently. Do it every day. Do it with determination. As long as it feels active, persuasive, you feel a sense of satisfaction doing it, and stay with it. Stay with it, because as I was alluding earlier, we are tremendously impatient creatures. We expect instant karma, so to speak, and that's not going to happen. There's going to be an interval of time. A human life takes 9 months to gestate. 9 months. So how long might a desire take to gestate? Could be much longer than that. Stay with it. And that's my formula for visualization, with due credit to Neville Goddard.
When we found out that Annie had a brain tumor, a very serious brain tumor, I thought to myself, I've got to get into this. I've got to do this.
Yeah.
And I said to Annie, we're going to sit together and we're going to try visualization, and we're going to try these techniques. We had another book about them at the time.
Uh-huh.
And she said, no, absolutely not.
Uh-huh.
This is mine.
Uh-huh.
This is my life. Mm-hmm. And this is what happens in my life. I'm not going to try to interrupt that. And what she was saying was that there are things in life that don't belong to the possibility of change.
Yes. Yes.
And you understand that very well, I think. And can you discuss with me a little bit about how to find the things that you can change instead of what we always do is we leap to the worst thing. My house burned down. I've got to visualize a new house. What we actually can do, Mitch, what can we do?
Yes, that's a wonderful, wonderful point. And there is a division on this point. There is a division. Some people who are involved in chaos magic or ceremonial magic, which I view as a cousin to the methods that you and I are discussing, they maintain that you have to be able to foresee some clear path of manifestation, so to speak, for what it is that you want. If you say you want to, you know, be married to some movie star, there's no real foreseeable path of completion. That circuit can't be closed. You have to be able to have some reasonable idea that this circuit can be closed. Other people, such as Neville, would have made the case, look, the mind is the ultimate arbiter, and this is possible. You can do this. For each individual, there has to be both over this matter, and it's a very intimate thing, and this is what Annie did. It's a very intimate process in which you have to determine, is this really emotionally persuasive to me within the realm of possibility of my life? And if it's not, I'm not going to permit anyone to direct me on a path that I don't emotionally and ethically believe in. Is this ethically persuasive to me on the path of my life? And to Annie, it was not ethically persuasive. She had a different existential point of view, and I applaud that. Now, there was a psychiatrist in Australia named Ainsley Mears, who did a great deal of work with people suffering from or who were diagnosed with terminal cancer and who were expecting the disease to be terminal and had discontinued all conventional treatment. And he engaged. He died in 1986, but he wrote for the traditional medical literature, which is why I value his career so much. Mears engaged in periods of intensive meditation with subjects who had been terminally diagnosed. I write about this in the book, but to simplify it, boil it down, he basically found there was about a 10% correlation between people who experienced cases of spontaneous or substantial remission, who were expected to be terminal, who had engaged in intensive meditation. This material is very delicate and very sensitive, and I write about it with great care in the book, and I'm speaking about it in shorthand now, but I want to be very clear about this. He found a correlation of intensive meditation and remission in about 10% of cases, 10%. Now, 10% is not nothing. 10% is a lot of people, but we are talking about 10%, and one has to be very aware that in terms of the multiple laws and forces under which we live, remarkable and anomalous things do happen. But this was a man who charted such things in conventional medical literature, and we have to be aware that there are courses that life takes that seem to be impervious at certain times to the nature of thought, that are in the nature of our lives in some broader way. And I think Annie ethically grasped that.
Yeah.
And
she became enlightened. She became enlightened at some point in the 2000s. I don't know. It could have been in 2005 or 2006, and I knew it. But she always would say to me, "The master who is called a master is not a master, and the master who calls himself a master is a child."
Yeah. Beautifully put.
Yeah, and so she, you know, we kept it very much in, you know, she lived and taught and as a person, but she knew a lot of things. And one of the things she knew was her own life plan. And when the brain tumor came, we all thought it was benign, something called a meningioma. Annie didn't think that. She knew what it was very well. And that this life plan was something that she was meant to surrender to, and she did. She had no intention of changing it, even if she could have.
Yes, and I honor that tremendously.
Yeah. So
and we must also
The point I'm getting at here is, folks, we have to know what we can change and embrace that. And Mitch, when you are looking in your own life, you find what things, points you think you can change. How do you find them?
I think we have moments in our lives of authentic perspective. We have moments where we see things from a higher or more sensitive state. And we also have certain ideals in life that we repeatedly return to. And our lives are almost like a spool that keeps revolving around this idea, whether we ever reach the center or not. I counsel people and myself to look very, very, very carefully at those things. When you have moments of exquisite perspective and you are imbued with the feeling that you can do something, that something is within your reach, that something that may seem extraordinary or cherished is a possibility. Those are real. There are moments of mature realization. When a certain theme or motif keeps returning in your life again and again and again, even if it's not centrally actualized in your life, it's just an ideal that you keep circling around and circling around, like saying, I want to live near water, or something like that, whatever it may be. Those repeat motifs in our lives are not to be ignored. They are not to be ignored. Use those moments of perspective to realize that there is an ethical open path there for you.
In the book, you talk some about prayer, which is really very interesting, I think, to me and probably to a lot of my listeners. In particular, repetitive prayer.
Yes.
As it happens, I'm in a reading group right now, and we're reading Maurice Nicole's book, The New Man.
Oh, how interesting.
Yeah, and one of the things in the book is, of course, about, there's a lot about prayer and how Jesus thought of prayer and how he taught us to pray, which gets me to repetitive prayer. And, of course, the modern classic on repetitive prayer, folks, if you want to read it from a very enjoyable writer, is J.D. Salinger's book, Franny and Zoe. his novella, because it's about repetitive prayer, and it's absolutely delightful. But, Mitch, you mentioned things like these extraordinary prayers, the 27-day novena, I believe it's called.
54.
54-day. And yeah. I want to – that much of the prayer part of this whole process is working hard again and again and again. And in my life with the visitors, this is exactly what they want, again and again and again, to continually do it and do it and do it.
Yeah.
And why is this repetition so important?
It's very interesting. It opens up on such an interesting topic. You know, as we've been alluding, there are times where a person cannot condition his psyche, where we feel such a sense of grief or such a sense of loss or difficulty or anxiety that it's impossible to enter into this feeling state. And I don't think that the cosmos play a cruel trick on us. I think prayer, in a sense, is the escape hatch from that. Prayer can be a way forward out of and beyond a place where you feel absolutely trapped. And I think that there should be no rules with regard to prayer. I think that prayer is something that is so intimate. You see it through, and you embark on it in whatever way suits your emotional state at the time. And if that is repetition, then let it be repetition. If that is begging, then let it be begging. If that is anger, then let it be anger. But nobody should make any rules as to how you must pray or how you must conduct yourself. It is anarchistic. It's radically in the hands of the individual. And I oppose any formula that would place a set of parameters on people.
One of the things that's central to my own life is meditation. I meditate twice a night, once at 11 and once at 3. And there has been physical communication from whoever's on the other side of this. If I don't wake up at 3, I absolutely never use an alarm, I will be awakened by one physical thing or another, which my listeners all know all about, so I'm not going to go into it in any detail. If you're curious about it and don't know about it, folks, write me at whitley@strieber.com. And, of course, if you want to get in touch with Mitch, you can get in touch with him through his website, or you can always write whitley@strieber.com, and we will forward your email to him.
Mm-hmm.
So how does meditation figure into this? It's obviously really important to somebody,
yep,
we don't know who is quite close to us, but who we can't see usually.
Yes. I think any spiritual practice requires some form of meditation, because everything around us in this world conspires to deprive us of silence. We are so surrounded by noise, by ambient light, by pitches, by people trying to get our attention and trying to get our money, and by all kinds of shiny, baubled objects. In fact, we even see within our own social relations that if we're being quiet or if we're not talking at the dinner table, somebody automatically thinks that there's something that must be wrong. We force children to talk. We think that if children are in a state of quiet, we have to somehow cajole them or push them and nudge them in some way to talk to us, to tell us what's going on. The very first step that you can take in getting in touch with the possibilities of something that is unseen, something that is beyond the given, is to resist this kind of passive campaign that ordinary life wages against us to deprive us of quiet. And one of the ways you can do that is through meditation, whether it's a kind of Zen, just sitting meditation, whether it's a sound meditation like transcendental meditation, where you receive a mantra, which is my personal commitment, whether it's a visualizing meditation, whether it's the use of the hypnagogic state, such as I've been describing. The first thing you can do to deprive the downward forces of conformity to a total claim on your existence is to meditate. So I think that's the starting point for really any search.
The starting point, which is where we are all at. And Annie used to say, you know, we should always be starting, always
yes,
at the starting point.
Beautifully put.
We are beginners. And she also would say, after she died, one of the things that I got from her was the human species is too young to have beliefs. We should have questions.
Yes, yes.
And, you know, we have been killing each other over beliefs and baseless fantasies, essentially, through all of our history and probably before it, too. So how does the question come into this, that great question that is me?
Yes. The question, I think, is probably one that we can only hope to deepen. What is it that we really want in life? What is it that you really wish to experience and to stand for in this brief period of time you're here? And don't condition it. Don't condition it. One of the things I do in the book, which might surprise people, is I defend attainment. I defend so-called materialism. I defend the wishes that a person might have that seem in conformity, in fact, with outer life, because we do live in both worlds. We live in a transcendent world. We live in a world of Caesar, and we owe something to both. So when I say don't condition whatever you feel the central purpose or need is of your life, I mean that so fully. I'm not trying to disguise within that principle the idea that you should come around to thinking in some so-called immaterialist way. I'm through at this point in my life making divisions between so-called inner, outer, personality, essence, lower, higher, attachment, non-attachment. I'm through with all of that. I feel that the individual does have moments of authentic experience, and that no one, whether they regard themselves as spiritual, whether they regard themselves as materialist, whether they don't think in such terms, no one can condition that for you, the individual. You must decide what that is, and don't get sidetracked by thinking, oh, you know, if I like what I decide, it must be essential, and if I don't like what I decide, it must be based on the personality, and I need to overcome it. Nonsense. This is your journey, and it's limited. It's limited based on our time within this particular experience. So be bold. Be bold.
Yeah. If there are people who talk about maybe one day we'll discover the secret of eternal life or living for 150 or 250 years, and I always think, oh, God, preserve us from this new curse.
Right, exactly.
Because we are here to make a journey, and it's a beautiful journey. But if we try to extend it beyond its limits, then it becomes a terrible, terrible wandering. We're not wandering. You're not wandering. I'm not wandering. My listeners, I don't think most of them are wandering. You should get the Miracle Club, How Thoughts Become Reality. It is very deep, beautiful stuff written in a way that you can literally get through it like I did in an afternoon. And I felt like I was about to levitate after I finished reading it, frankly.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, it's the truth, Mitch. It's a lovely and so authoritative. You know what you're talking about, man. And that's great. His website is MitchHorowitz.com. He's all over Facebook. You can find him there. You can find him on Twitter. Mitch Horowitz, a remarkable man in this age where we need many of them. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Whitley. Such a pleasure.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.